Okay. So, it's really a pleasure to be here. So I'm going to talk about gravity, mostly from a field theoretical viewpoint. So I asked you guys whether you know general relativity, but in fact, for the first part of my lectures, let's say today and maybe next time, tomorrow, I will not use the language of general relativity. So usually when we talk about gravity, after Einstein, we talk about the curvature of space-time, the metric, geodesics, all that stuff. So the so-called geometric interpretation of gravity. And of course, that's very valuable and it's extremely useful because it's an extremely powerful tool to talk about nonlinear phenomena in gravity. But in fact, what I want to emphasize for today and tomorrow is that picture is not fundamental. As far as we understand, that picture emerges from trying to enforce the axioms of quantum mechanics and Lorentz invariance on massless spin two particles. Okay, so my viewpoint will be, at least for today, that gravity is really a phenomenon that has to do with interacting massless spin two particles, okay, and in a Lorentz invariant world. Okay, so we'll not talk about the curvature of space-time for today and tomorrow. Space-time is flat, and we will talk about particles propagating and interacting in this flat space-time. And we'll see how the usual geometric picture emerges from this viewpoint. Okay, so this approach was pioneered in the 1960s by Weinberg and then by others, Feynman, and finally, and others, and finally completed by Bulwer and Deser. And the upshot is that general relativity emerges as the unique, consistent theory of massless spin two particles interacting in a Lorentz invariant fashion. Okay? Massless spin two particles, I will call gravitons, because as far as we understand, gravity is mediated by particles that are massless and they have spin. Okay? So I will use so called natural units, h bar and c are set to 1. And I think I've been consistent with my notes to set the metric, the flat metric of space-time, the Minkowski metric, to be minus plus plus, so the mostly plus signature, okay? Which is what you usually use in relativity, in general relativity, let's say, whereas in particle physics, you usually use the opposite one, okay? So let's just write it here. So for us, gravity will be massless spin two particles, which I will call gravitons. Okay? And we'll try to construct the most generic quantum field theory that is consistent with quantum mechanics Lorentz invariance for these particles. Okay? So turns out to be an interesting exercise because you'll see how certain things that we give for granted are in fact quite subtle. In particular, what it means to be spin two for a massless particle. So spin for massless particles is a subtle concept, okay? And those subtleties are not just technical technicalities. They turn out to be the origin of what we call gauge invariance for gauge theories like the photon, and or in the case of gravity, of diffeomorphism invariance. Okay, so those subtleties that have to do with how particles transform under spin transformations, massless particles, turn out to be physically very relevant. Okay, and all the features of general relativity will follow from these subtleties. Okay, so let's start talking about spin. Okay, so spin in non-relativistic quantum mechanics is we know what it is. A set of degrees of freedom for each particle that tells you how those particle states transform under rotations. Okay, now if you have a relativistic theory, so you have a relativistic particle, it becomes a little more subtle. So if the particle is massive, you can go to the rest frame, define spin in the usual way, that is to say, like in non-relativistic quantum mechanics, and then so once you know how the particle states transform in the rest frame under rotations, you can just boost this information to any other frame by applying a Lorentz boost. Okay, for massless particles you cannot do that, because massless particles don't have a rest frame. They always travel at the speed of light. Okay, so we will have to understand how to define spin for massless particles. Okay, so in general, massive or massless, if I have a single particle state, I can label the state by the momentum of the particle. The energy is related to the momentum, okay, by using the usual E square minus P square equals M square. So once you know the mass, could be zero, could be non-zero, you know the energy if you know the momentum, okay? So the energy is a redundant variable if you want. So we just need the momentum to define a state, and then a spin variable, let me call it sigma, okay? This could be, for instance, in relativistic quantum mechanics, M, the projection of the spin operator onto the z-axis, okay? So let's say, so for a single particle state of a particle of mass m and total spin s, this is a complete parametrization of the state, okay? And so when we apply a Lorentz transformation unit operator, U of lambda, lambda is a Lorentz transformation, U is the unitary operator associated with it in the Hilbert space, okay? What do we get? Well, we get certainly that the momentum gets transformed by the corresponding Lorentz transformation. By this, I mean simply lambda mu nu p nu. This would be the four vector. I'm interested in just the spatial part, so I might as well call this lambda I. Okay, so this is what I mean by this notation. Okay, lambda p vector. And then the spin variables, these are internal degrees of freedom, if you want, of this particle, okay, get reshuffled in a way that depends on the Lorentz transformation. So there's going to be a new spin variable sigma prime here, and then here there's going to be a matrix, let me call it D, following the standard notation. This matrix depends on the Lorentz transformation I'm performing. The Lorentz transformation could be a boost, could be a rotation, could be a combination of the two, okay? And so I have a matrix that mixes all the spin degrees of freedom. Okay, so it's a matrix in sigma sigma prime space, and under a generic Lorentz transformation, they get reshuffled. Okay, this, if you think about, okay, if you think about it, is what we mean by a particle with spin. That if we apply a Lorentz transformation, which could contain a rotation, okay, the spin variables get reshuffled. Okay, so these are internal degrees of freedom that get reshuffled under a generic Lorentz transformations. Okay, this in the literature is called a Wigner rotation. So it's the rotation of the spin variables, is the matrix that mixes the spin variables associated with a generic Lorentz transformation. Okay, now, for massive particles, as I said, the situation is very similar to what happens in quantum mechanics. So if I'm given a generic state with a generic four momentum, so let's say this is the momentum of my particle, I can perform a Lorentz transformation that takes me to another p mu, let me call it k mu. It's a reference k mu that I choose once and for all, and in particular I choose it to be the rest frame of the particle. So I perform a Lorentz transformation that brings me to the rest frame, okay? And there I just want to study now how the particle states transform under Lorentz transformations that do not change this k mu, okay? So the subgroup of Lorentz transformation by the way, I'm reviewing, I hope, things that are familiar to many of you who have taken quantum field theory classes, okay? But I'm reviewing them because they show some of the subtleties. Subgroup of Lorentz transformations that does not change k mu, so this rest frame for momentum. This is called the little group of K mu. Why do I want to focus on that part? Because once I know how things transform under the little group, okay, in particular, notice that since by definition, the little group does not change the momentum, in this case, the momentum is zero, okay? It corresponds to Lorentz transformations here that do not change P, okay, and they only are non-trivial in terms of this matrix that mixes the spin degrees of freedom. So in a sense, this is the group that tells me what spin is, how particle states transform under spin transformations. Whatever we define as spin, it has to be this, okay? It has to be the subset of Lorentz transformations that do not change the momentum, so that I can just focus on this matrix. Once I know the states transform under those transformations, the little group of K mu, then by applying, by undoing boost, by undoing this Lorentz transformation here, I can just translate whatever transformation properties I have in the rest frame to any other frame, okay? So this for massive particles is very easy, for massive particles is very easy because, again, it's exactly the same as in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. Okay? So for m different from zero, little group, let me call it LG, of K mu, of rotations, okay? Because if I apply a three-dimensional rotation, I'm not changing the energy because that only changes under boosts. I'm not changing the momentum because the momentum is zero, so it doesn't rotate, okay? So the little group of the K mu of a massive particle in its rest frame is just a group of rotations, okay? And I know what the representations are. They are the usual representations of spin, okay? So I know what these matrices are, depending on the spin S of the particle. Could be zero, could be one half, could be one, okay? I have different matrices here. By the way, this SO3, if you want, you can replace with SU2 if you want to talk about half integer spins, okay? And so in the case of a particle with S equals zero, this is just the identity. In the case of a particle with spin one, these are just rotation matrices in the vector representation, okay? In the case of a particle with spin one half, these are polymatrices, etc. Okay, so for massive particles, we already know the answer from non-relativistic quantum mechanics. Okay, now for a massless particle, the situation is much trickier. Okay, so let's do the massless particle. I cannot go to the rest frame, as I said, but I can apply the same logic. Once I choose a reference K mu, which will not take this form because there's no rest frame, but once I choose a reference K mu, I can study how the particle states can transform in that frame, so I can study the little group of that frame, of that K mu, and then once I know how things transform in that frame, I can boost back to any other frame and read off the transformation properties, okay? So we have a choice now. So for massive particles, the choice of K mu was obvious. It's a convenient choice, go to the rest frame. Here we have a choice to choose an arbitrary K mu now as our reference for momentum. We can choose, for instance, to align the spatial momentum to the z-axis. We could do x, we could do y, doesn't matter, okay? Choose just one axis. So go whenever you have trivial P mu, like before. Now apply a Lorentz transformation and go to this particular frame. It will be a different energy in general. Let me call it E prime. Okay. And okay. And now we have this reference frame. We chose it once and for all, and now we study it. And so we want to study now the little group of this K mu, the subgroup of Lorentz transformations that do not change K mu. Okay? Once we understand how particle states transform under that group, then by undoing Lorentz transformation, we can transform any other state. I'm gonna keep this. Okay. So what is the little group of this K mu? What's the subgroup of transformations that do not change K mu? Rotation is about the Z axis, okay? That's the obvious answer, and it's correct, but it's not the full answer, okay? But let's write it down for the moment. So the little group certainly contains SO2 around Z. Okay, if I rotate around Z, I don't change this guy. These are zeros, so they don't rotate into each other, and I don't change the energy either, okay? And usually, we say that, yes, massless particle states transform under this SO2, in general, in a non-trivial way, okay? And there's a quantum number associated with it, which is called helicity, okay? Because remember, SO2, which is just rotations in a plane, is an abelian group, okay? And in particular, its representations are very, yes.
Is that the exact same game that you play now with a massive particle? And you should somehow still have an SO3 for a little group, right?
Why?
You could choose KMU for a massive particle, so often you'll have to see. It's your choice.
Yes.
You chose KMU, the smarter KMU, to be in the red frame.
Yes.
You could have chosen to be in that frame. And if you did that, is it obvious to see how you recreate SO3 also for. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
So you, for a massive particle, you've also chosen KU to be along with
it. Yes, yes.
So you can still be able to recreate SO3.
No, but then that momentum wouldn't be valid for a massive particle.
You're right.
It will be a different energy, you're saying. Yeah. Yes, yes. It will be a different energy. Good point. Now, the point, so let's see how this evolves, because there's going to be an extra ingredient here in the little group, and so maybe once you combine two ingredients for a massive particles, you get I never done the exercise. It's a good question. Maybe when you combine two ingredients for a massive particle, you get SO3. Let's see how I keep going. Okay, that's a good point. Okay, so SO2 as represented, or U1, SO2 is the same as U1. So you know that its representations are one-dimensional. You just have a phase. Okay, the only irreducible representations of U1 are phases. Okay, and so this sigma prime that I was talking about, in fact, becomes just a phase e to the I h times transformation. So with each Lorentz transformation, there's going to be an associated SO2 rotation, okay, that depends on the Lorentz transformation you're performing, and there's a number here, the charge, if you want, for this U1 transformation. And that number is called helicity. Now, from the viewpoint of the algebra, meaning commutation relations, there's no quantization condition on the helicity. The helicity could be a continuous number from the viewpoint of the algebra. Okay? But it turns out, unlike for SO3, for SO3 the algebra, since it's a non-abelian algebra, is so constrained that you only get discrete representations labeled by the spin S, okay? So here, helicity could be continuous from algebraic viewpoint only. But it turns out that if you take into account the global properties of Lorentz transformations, that is to say the topology of the Lorentz group, it turns out that the helicity, again, is quantized in units of 1/2. So it could be 0, plus or minus 1/2, plus or minus 1, etc. Okay. Notice that this is an irreducible representation, okay? So each value of H corresponds to a different irreducible representation. So in particular, there could be particles with only one helicity, let's say positive helicity. In particular, if neutrinos were massless in the standard model, they would have, left-handed neutrinos would have helicity plus 1/2, and there wouldn't be anything with helicity minus 1/2, okay? So there's no need, if you want, for having two different helicities for a given particle species, okay? Okay, now, as I said, the SO2 here is not the end of the story, and the reason is this. So let's go back to that for momentum there, KMU, okay? So let's look at the three-dimensional part, because again, energy is completely constrained by the mass shell condition, okay? So we have our momentum K, along the z direction, okay, which in particular is equal to e prime. Okay, so the SO2 associated with elicity corresponds to rotations about this axis, but there's another set of Lorentz transformations you could perform that do not change k. Okay, so for instance, you could first let me do it like this. You could first boost, let's say, along this x direction. So this x and this is y. Along the y direction, I can perform a boost. Okay, so the momentum changes. Okay, changes both in its direction and in its magnitude, but because a boost changes the energy. Okay, then I could rotate. So this is a boost. Then I could rotate back to the z-axis. Okay, so let's say this is k prime, this is k double prime. K double prime is not the same as k because the original boost changed the energy, so it changed the overall magnitude of the momentum. So when I rotate, I'm ending up with a different momentum. And so now, if I want to bring back to k, I can just boost back. Okay. So this is a combination of boost, rotation, and boost. Okay, that does not change k, but it's a totally non-trivial Lorentz transformation on other momenta, on other four vectors. Okay, so this is also part of the little group. If you think about it, you have two parameters controlling such transformations, because first of all, if I choose to boost only along y initially, okay, I can decide how much to boost, so that's one free parameter. Then everything else is constrained. I could have chosen to do a boost initially along x, okay? That's an independent parameter. And depending on that parameter, then everything else is constrained. So overall, I have two parameters controlling this set of Lorentz transformations, telling me how much I boost initially along x and along y. And then everything else is constrained, okay? So I have a two-parameter addition to that little group, okay? You can write them down explicitly. I'm not going to because it's sort of boring. Okay, but they are on Weinberg, for instance, on quantum field theory book of Weinberg. And so let me call these two generators, two extra generators associated with this Lorentz transformation. Let me call them A and B. So these are operators, okay, that generate this combination of Lorentz transformations. And this guy, let me call it JZ. These are rotations around the z-axis. Okay, you can write down the algebra. Now, the claim is that these are the only, the little group is made up of these guys. So these are the only Lorentz transformations that do not change the four momentum k mu that we wrote down. Okay, so it has three generators, JZ, A and B. And the algebra is this. A and B commute. Well, this class of Lorentz transformations is a two-parameter thing, no? Because, well, let's see. So I could have chose, if you want, the two parameters are like this. I can choose the initial direction of the boost, the initial boost that I'm making in the xy plane. So that's an angle, so it's a one parameter. And then I can also choose how much to boost. That's a second parameter. Once I do that, everything else is constrained because the rotation angle here is constrained and the boost back is also constrained. So at least for this class of Lorentz transformations, you have two parameters. The initial boost takes two parameters and then everything else is constrained. Okay? It turns out that these two guys plus rotations around Z are the only elements of the little group. Okay? So let me write down the algebra with the sign, the correct signs. So A and B commute, JZ A is plus IB. And JZ B is minus IA. Okay? This is the algebra of the little group. Well, this is the algebra. Let me write it like the ISO 2. What's ISO? ISO is the Euclidean group. Euclidean group means translations and rotations in dimensions. Okay? Why? Well, if I interpret A and B as translation operators, two translations commute. If you want, they are like momentum operators, but they are not the physical moment of the particle. They are some sort of internal momentum degrees of freedom. It's a funny degree of freedom, okay? So two momentum operators commute, and they get transformed, they get rotated into each other by rotating in the plane. This is exactly the algebra of rotations. And I'm going to put it in quote, translations in 2D. Okay, these are abstract translations. They're not the real translations of space-time. These are abstract translations. Okay? So you see that SO2, and so the associated quantum number helicity, is only part of the story of how a massless particle state could transform. Okay? Now, the problem with the translation part of these transformations, the part associated with A and B, is that if you have a non-trivial, suppose your particle state, your superparticle state is an eigenstate of these transformations with a non-trivial eigenvalues for A and B, okay, to be like having non-trivial momentum in this abstract space, in that sort of space, then by rotations, by applying rotations, whenever you have a non-trivial eigenvalue, let me call it AB, it's a two-dimensional vector, this set of eigenvalues for A and B. By rotations, you can transform it to any other two-dimensional vector with the same modulus, okay? Meaning that if you have a state with a non-trivial set of eigenvalue A and B, you also have a state with A prime, B prime, which are just a rotated version A and B in two dimensions, okay? This is exactly like for momentum. So if I have a momentum like this, by rotations, I also have an eigenstate of momentum like this in the Hilbert space, yes. No. But then we go back to his question, because maybe I have to follow the algebra for how you get these commutators. Maybe you are using the massness of the particle. Forget exactly. I have to think about your question. It's a good question. Well, in general, it's not a subgroup of SO3, because SO3 has three generators. This guy has three generators. The algebras are different, so they cannot be the same. Okay, but anyway, so what's the problem with this? Okay, so we are saying if I have a non-trivial eigenstate of A and B with non-trivial eigenvalues, then I also have another eigenstate with also non-trivial eigenvalues. And we are totally used to this for momentum, okay? So if I have an eigenstate like this for momentum, I also have an eigenstate like this, okay? But apart from that, particles that we know of do not have this feature. This would be a continuous degree of freedom for a particle beyond momentum, okay? Once you fix momentum, this is an internal degree of freedom that can take continuous values. We don't know of any particle like that. In fact, there were claims, classic claims in the literature, that this would be inconsistent, because if you want, you have so many degrees of freedom, because these are continuous variables, you can take infinitely many values. You have so many internal degrees of freedom for such a particle, if it existed, that you'd violate basic facts about thermodynamics, for instance, because everything would be divergent in thermodynamics, because thermodynamic properties are proportional to the number of degrees of freedom. In fact, there's been recent progress. I just want to mention it as an aside. There's been progress by Toro. So if you are interested in this, Schuster and Toro. There's a series of papers whose titles have to do with the continuous spin particles, okay, in which they examine these representations, these non-trivial representations, more critically, and they find that those claims that these representations are inconsistent are unwarranted, and maybe you can construct a non-trivial quantum field for these particles. They're very complicated. So, for instance, to write down local field operators for these particles become very complicated, okay? But the traditional viewpoint, so apart from this recent progress that is mostly formal, meaning they don't claim that it has anything to do with nature, okay? But apart from recent progress, the standard viewpoint is that, okay, so we don't observe particles with this continuum of freedom. So the only possibility, at least if you want, the particles that are ionized in nature that we know of correspond to A and B equals zero. They correspond to trivial representations for the translation part of the little group. Okay? Known particles. Have A equal B equals zero. Okay? In that case, this argument has no, is completely harmless, no? Because zero gets rotated to zero, so you can just state. Okay? So bottom line that if you assume that A and B equals zero, is that massless particles are characterized by helicity, okay? And helicity takes one value, could be zero, could be plus one half, minus one half, plus one, minus one, etc. Exactly, but the point is that this additional degree of freedom is not like, so if I tell you that a particle is spin one, okay? The spin degree of freedom tells you that there are three independent states for that associated with spin, okay? Here the problem is that the representation of this group, once A and B are non-trivial, the representation of this group is infinite dimensional, and this extra degree of freedom that we're talking about is a continuous variable. So for every single particle, there will be an internal continuous degree of freedom, okay? And that's not observed. So, meaning that, well, exactly, so you should read this paper, because it turns out that once you try to make sense of this, it becomes a very, very complicated thing. But for instance, it would correspond, in the language of helicity, it would correspond to having many, infinitely many helicities all together, okay? Meaning that single particle states for, let's say, a massless particle with these properties will correspond to infinitely many helicities altogether that get transformed to each other by Lorentz transformations. So okay? Yes. Yeah. And not only that, but that the internal degrees of freedom of this particle correspond to infinitely many states once you fix the momentum, which is not something we observe. Okay? Okay, any other questions? It also turns out that once you assume this, and this is only true if I assume this, once you assume this, helicity turns out to be Lorentz invariant, okay? Even though helicity, if you think about it, since it's the quantum number associated with rotations about the z-axis, helicity can be written in a rotation invariant way like this, j dot the direction of your momentum, and this doesn't look Lorentz invariant because it's only a three-dimensional product, okay? It turns out that once you assume that A and B are zero for the single particle states you're talking about, then the helicity of that particle is Lorentz invariant, okay? Which is something non-trivial. Okay, now this sounds super formal and boring, but you see that it's important, okay? So let's see why it's important. But the bottom line at the level of single particle states is that the little group is more complicated than just rotations, okay? Single particle states apparently correspond to trivial representations of A and B, and so they just have non-trivial transformation properties under rotations about their axis, their momentum. But when you try to write down a local field theory for these single particle states, those extra Lorentz transformations turn out to be a problem or a feature, meaning your field operators will transform non-trivial under those, okay? So to appreciate why it's subtle, let's go back to massive particles for a second, okay? Now suppose we want to write down a local field operator to describe massive particles, meaning a local field operator that creates and destroys these massive particles with a certain spin. Okay? So the idea is this. So we characterize the transformation properties of single particle states under rotations in the rest frame, okay? And then we know how to boost to any other frame. So let's do the same for field operators. So to construct field operators, usually what do we have? We have a superposition of momenta. We have creation and annihilation operators. We have plane waves, okay? And if the spin of the particle is not trivial, we need polarization vectors, tensors, spinors, etc. Okay? We need some, for instance, for a spin one particle, we need some epsilon mu that we want to put in front of the creation operators, and that carries the spin property, the spin information about the particles we are trying to destroy or create. Okay? So let's do the example, the spin one example for massive particles. Okay? So the idea is the following. We look for some epsilon mu, some polarization vector, test the same transformation properties as the single under Lorentz transformations, as the single particle states we are trying to create and destroy. So in particularly in the rest frame, okay, so for zero momentum, if you want, if I'm trying to describe a particle with spin 1, I know what the representations with spin r is at the level of four vectors, okay? They take this form, epsilon mu, let's say I will have three guys, spin 0, spin plus 1, and spin minus 1. Okay? And their time components will be 0. And the spatial components will be, the spin zero guy will be aligned with the y-axis. The spin one plus one will be, let me use the same normalization. It doesn't really matter, but let me use the same normalizations that I have there, over square root of 2, plus I, 0, over square root of 2. Okay? So the claim here, the claim is that this set of three, four vectors under rotations, okay, transform into each other in a spin one representation, okay? And in particular, this label 0 plus 1 minus 1 denotes the eigenvalue they have under rotations around the z-axis. As usual, we characterize spin in terms of total spin and then eigenvalue around some axis, let's say the z-axis, okay? So why is this a good idea, okay? Why do I want to find four vectors that have the same transformation properties as the single particle states I'm trying to describe? Because now I can construct a vector field operator, let me call it V mu. Ah, by the way, sorry. This is in the rest frame, okay? These are the good polarization vectors I want to use in the rest frame. And then in any other frame, just boost. Okay, so for momenta that are different from zero, I just take the boost associated with going from the rest frame to that momentum, and I apply the same boost to these guys. Okay, and I define those as the polarization vectors associated with those particles. Okay, why is this a good idea? Because now I can construct a local field operator like this. So I use the usual normalization. Okay, I sum over spin variables, so sigma zero plus or minus one. Okay. And then use epsilon mu, polarization sigma, momentum p, annihilation operator, e to the I p x, plus Hermitian conjugate. Yeah, that will be relevant for massless particles. Sorry, it's definition. Meaning, I'm saying in the rest frame, I define these three guys, and then I define. So these are, if you want, these are good questions because they're really. So these are the, by definition, these are the polarization vectors associated with zero momentum. The zero vector is momentum, okay? And then I define epsilon mu sigma at any other p as being the Lorentz transformation that brings me, let's say, from zero to p. Which, by the way, is non-unique because I could perform certain rotations, so there are some subtleties here. But let's say a Lorentz transformation that brings me from zero momentum to p, and I apply it to these guys, sorry, the other way around, new zero. Okay, so by this is a definition, so for the moment there's no assumption here. It's a definition of what we mean by these four vectors. Okay, now according to this definition, why is it a useful definition? Because of what I'm going to say now. Okay, so let's be explicit about what's an operator here. This is an operator, is a field operator, and the only operators here are the annihilation and creation operators. Okay, now what does it mean that this is a four vector operator? It means that if I apply the unitary operator associated with Lorentz transformations in the Hilbert space, so these are, okay, I want this guy, so I want this to yield the usual transformation properties of a four vector field, okay, which I mean, there's some issues about active and passive, but let's say that with my notations this should be the inverse Lorentz transformation mu nu to v nu as an operator lambda x. Okay, that's the question. So I'm trying to construct a combination of operators and phases and polarization vectors on the right hand side that gives me this, okay? Because that's the goal. I want to construct local field operators with simple transformation properties under Lorentz, so that if I stick them into a Lagrangian, I know that the dynamic, as long as I contract the indices in the usual way, the Lagrangian is going to be Lorentz invariant, so the dynamics are going to be Lorentz invariant. Okay? Now, this looks super pedantic, okay? But you'll see the four massless particles, that's where the problem is. Okay, so let's go through it. Okay? So is this true? Turns out to be true. Okay? Let me sketch, I mean, we could go through the algebra, it's sort of boring, but let me sketch why it's true. It's true because when I apply these unitary operators to this guy, okay, everything here is a C number apart from the creation and annihilation operators, okay? So I'm looking now at U, A, U minus 1, okay? That's the only non-trivial part. Now, the creation and annihilation operators, sorry, by the way, this also have to do with polarization sigma, okay? The creation and annihilation operators, since they are directly related to single particle states, because they connect single particle states to the vacuum, they inherit their transformation properties, Lorentz, from the single particle states. Remember the first line we wrote down was U lambda P sigma was a given matrix, D sigma sigma prime, summed over sigma primes, lambda P sigma prime, okay? So from here, you can read off what this is, okay? It will be A, apart from normalization factors, it will be A associated with the new momentum and with new polarization vector, label, and there's gonna be a matrix relating, mixing the labels, okay? Now, interpret that spin matrix as once I do it in here, as now acting on epsilon. Okay, that's why it's useful that epsilon be in the same representation as the single particle states, because A has the same transformation properties as single particle states, and if epsilon also does, then you can move the D matrix to this guy, okay, and get the new epsilon rotated under the same rotation. Okay, turns out that also all the boosts of the momentum work out, meaning that I'm gonna get lambda P here. Okay, once I apply this rotation matrix, I can rewrite it as a combination of epsilon with the new momentum lambda p, okay? I change variables inside the integral. It's a set of standard, algebraic steps, okay? There's nothing fancy going on. The only trivial part is the fact that epsilon and a are in the same representation of the little group. That's the only non-trivial part, okay? And so overall, once you change variables inside the integral, you really get that this is obeyed, okay? Which is a non-trivial statement. I mean, I'm applying two unitary operators in the Hilbert space, and I end up on the right-hand side with a Lorentz transformation that has to do now with the mu nu contractions in the usual way, okay? Meaning, on the right-hand side, there's no more unitary operator going on. It's just a contraction of indices in the usual way. So this fact is non-trivial and is useful because now it means that if I stick v mu in a Lagrangian and I contract indices in the usual way, That Lagrangian is guaranteed to give me Lorentz invariant physics, because that contraction of indices in the usual way is invariant under Lorentz transformations in this sense, but Lorentz transformations in this sense are equivalent to quantum Lorentz transformations in the Hilbert space. Okay? Are there questions about this point? As I said, this sounds pedantic, so maybe it's obvious for you guys, but you see for massless particles, it's not. Yes. This guy, yeah, sorry. Yes. I'm doing mu, yes. Thank you. Are there questions about this? Because now we're going to try to do the same for massless particles. It doesn't work, but that will be the origin of gauge invariance. So let's do it for spin one, okay? And then we'll do it for spin two. For spin two is just the same as for spin one. So let's do first spin one, which is a little simpler. Okay? Again, everything worked out here because epsilon and A, or epsilon in single particle states, were in the same representations of the little group. Okay? Okay, now let's do it for spin one. So we are saying we have a K mu, which is this guy, is proportional up to energy to 1001. Okay? The part of the little group we are interested in, as we said, is rotations around the z-axis, because we are assuming that the single particle states do not transform under the rest. Okay? And so we have to find epsilon mu's that transform under those rotations, or rotations around the z-axis, in that frame, exactly in the same sense. By the way, let me be explicit, so let's use helicity, okay? And let me consider both helicities, plus and minus one, even though, as I said, technically we could consider just one of the two, plus one or minus one, they are in different irreducible representations of the Lorentz group. In practice, let's say, at least for the photon or for the graviton, as far as we know, they have both helicities because the two helicities are connected by parity, and as far as we know, electromagnetic interactions and gravitational interactions do not violate parity. So if you have plus one, you also have minus one. Okay? So let's do it with both. So we are looking for two polarization vectors, plus one and minus one, that transform like single particle states under rotations about the z-axis. And we don't have to look very far. Okay, so under rotations about the z-axis, these two get, one plus I gets a phase, okay? So this has exactly the same helicity as the particle is trying to describe, meaning if I apply a rotation, a Lorentz transformation, which is a rotation of some angle theta about the z-axis, and applying to epsilon nu, I get e to the I plus or minus theta, and that's it, times epsilon mu. Okay? So this is exactly the same representation as the single particle states you're trying to describe. Okay. However, and let's do the same that we were doing for massive particles, meaning now for any other momentum, let's apply the Lorentz transformation that brings me from K mu to this new momentum P mu, okay? And then let's apply to those guys, okay? So these are the epsilon nu plus or minus one associated with K. definition. Okay? So from this viewpoint, again, there's no subtlety, meaning they are for vectors simply because I'm defining them to transform as for vectors. Okay, this is a definition. Okay. However, you see that there's a problem now. Okay. And the problem is that you don't maintain this structure. So for instance, suppose you apply one of the infamous transformations of the little group, the famous boost plus rotation plus boost. Okay. That acts non-trivially on these epsilon mu's, okay? Because it only acted trivially on K mu because K mu was aligned with the z-axis, okay? But these guys are not aligned with the z-axis. So when I apply one of those little group transformations, I don't go back. I go back to K mu, but I don't go back to the structure, okay? In general, what you can show is that, if you want, if you apply a Lorentz transformation associated with the little group, the other part of the little group, alpha being, alpha and beta being the parameters associated with A and B, okay? Let's apply one of these little group Lorentz transformations to these epsilons, plus or minus one at K, okay? What you get is the same, which you like, plus something proportional to K mu. If you want to be super pedantic, it looks like this. Alpha plus or minus I beta, 1 over square root 2 K, K mu. Okay? So, the epsilons, yes, are the parameters associated with A and B generators in the little group. So if I apply, those are the eigenvalues of the single particle states, okay? I'm saying, suppose I perform a transformation, remember that I was telling you, these new transformations are associated with two parameters, the initial boost somehow, the initial boost has two parameters, which is not the same as saying the eigenstates of the, sorry, the eigenvalues of the single particle state. So this Lorentz transformation that I perform is defined by two parameters, okay? I perform it. The claim is the single particle state is invariant under this transformation, regardless of the two parameters I'm using, because it's an eigenstate with eigenvalues zero. But epsilon mu is not. Epsilon mu transforms non-trivially. Let's get this piece, okay? So epsilon mu, turns out, is not in the presentation of the little group as the single particle states. Not in the same position as single particle states, P plus or minus, helicity plus or minus one, of the little group. Even though it has the helicity, meaning under rotations, it has the same. The little group is bigger, and the single particle state is supposed to be invariant, epsilon mu is not, under these AB transformations. Okay? So, now, if I construct a field operator, I did previously, notice I'm using a constructive approach, using only physical helicities. I'm never talking about, when you talk about the quantization of QED, you have unphysical polarizations, etc. I'm not using that, okay? I'm trying to construct the theory using only physical states, okay? So if I sum over the two polarizations, let's say helicity plus or minus one, and I construct a field operator in the usual way, let me write it an upper index, I don't know, upper or lower. Let me use upper this time. Helicity, e to the IPX, plus Hermitian conjugate, okay? I just guess that this is my field operator based on the example I had for massive particles, okay? I just do the same guess, okay? And now I try to check again whether this transforms like a Lorentz vector under Lorentz transformations. The fact there is a mu index doesn't mean much, okay? Because Lorentz transformations in Hilbert space act with unitary operators, so I have to apply the correct unit operator and check, okay? Okay? And for this to work out as before, I would like it to be this lambda minus one mu nu a mu lambda x. Let's see if this is true. Okay. So let's try. So again, I want to look at this guy because it's the only non-trivial operator in here. So when I bracket a with u minus one, I just end up with bracketing the creation and annihilation operators. The creation and annihilation operators have the same transformation properties as the single particle they're associated with. So they just transform under the density part of the little group, more general part. Generic Lorentz transformation that contains some non-trivial A and B transformation here of the little group, okay? The A does not transform under that part, okay? But then what I was doing before, I was moving whatever the transformation properties of A were, in particular that matrix D sigma sigma prime, to epsilon, because they were in the same representation. Now they're not anymore, because A does not transform under A and B, but epsilon does. So when you try to play the same trick, I won't go through the details, but you can imagine what happens, okay? You get exactly what was happening before, so nice contraction of indices, Lorentz transformation, matrices, etc. Plus, there's going to be an extra piece associated with the non-trivial transformation properties of epsilon under this part of the little group. In Fourier transform, it goes like k mu, okay? So when I sum over all momenta, k mu becomes a derivative of something, okay? So there's going to be the d mu of something, let me call it little lambda. It depends on the Lorentz transformation I'm performing. It's a specific combination of creation and annihilation operators with plane waves, etc., and these factors, 1 over k, etc., okay? It depends on the Lorentz transformation I'm performing and is a function of x. It's an operator, okay? It's a generic. It's a fairly complicated combination of creation and annihilation operators with phases and stuff. Okay? So the claim is that if you start from single states, only physical polarizations for massless particles, and you construct the field operator in the usual way, it does not transform as a Lorentz vector. It transforms as a Lorentz vector under Lorentz transformations plus something else. Everything's flat space. I'm reluctant to go in that direction because the moment you have curved space, Lorentz transformations are not a symmetry anymore, and so I'm not sure how to use this logic. Because, for instance, well, we have to be careful now because this logic emphasizes the importance of, interpreting particles, the particle states as representations of the Poincaré group. If the Poincaré group is not a symmetry, then I'm not sure how to use it systematically. So I'm sure one can say some words like you're saying, but I'm not sure how general you can be. Fear binds, well, if you want to use since lambda, little lambda, there is a scalar, the covariant derivative and the ordinary derivative are the same. More in general, for instance, what I'm going to say next about gravity, it could be more complicated. But are there any other questions? Yes. Well, because there's no... So first of all, the fact that I'm considering plus and minus one together is just because, again, of parity, meaning I know that electromagnetic interactions, it's an experimental fact, do not violate parity. So parity flips the sign of helicity because the helicity is j dot p. J is invariant under parity, but p is not. So parity flips the sign of helicity. So if I have helicity one states, I also have helicity minus one states. But from the viewpoint of Lorentz transformations without parity, so from the viewpoint of the representations of the continuous part of the Lorentz group, helicities are completely separate. So I could consider particles with only helicity plus one and never talk about plus one if I wanted to. Okay? So in particular, zero does not enter the picture because there's nothing connecting plus one and minus one to zero. Whereas in the usual, because remember, this is a quantum number associated with SO2. SO2 has only transformations of this form, meaning, sorry, SO2, the representations of SO2 just correspond to one-dimensional representations that just pick up a phase, unlike rotations in three dimensions. In three dimensions, you have a more complicated algebra of rotations, and so the moment you have spin plus one along the z-axis and spin minus one, you also have spin zero. Not so for SO2. So helicity, you shouldn't interpret it as being one of the usual transformation properties under three-dimensional rotations. You see what I mean? Yeah, but it's a so from this viewpoint, it's completely different. It's a different particle, no? And it doesn't need to exist. And in fact, from this viewpoint, you never talk about it. Yes. That's a good question. I don't know. In fact, I was thinking about it. I don't know how to do it for spin one and so helicity one and helicity two. Meaning that we can talk about it later. But for instance, for fermions, we are very used to it. So, for fermions in the standard model violates parity at order one. And in fact, I mean, left-handed and right-handed fermions couple to gauge bosons in very different ways. And there's nothing surprising about it. For bosons, it's a little trickier. For bosons with high spins, we can talk about it. Meaning, from the viewpoint of Lorentz representations, there's no problem. When you start to construct local field operators, it's not trivial how to write down consistent interactions. But I think it's a good point. It's a good question. Okay, so you see now the viewpoint. The viewpoint is that you're always trying, even for massless particles with spin, you're always trying to enforce Lorentz invariance. This piece, which all of you, I hope, recognize as a gauge transformation on the electromagnetic, on the photon field, okay, arises from this viewpoint just as an unwanted piece in the Lorentz transformation properties of A mu. Okay, so if I use physical polarizations for spin one particles, A mu transforms as a four vector plus an extra piece. Okay? So from this viewpoint, gauge invariance of, let's say, the Maxwell Lagrangian is just a trick, meaning it is a trick to implement Lorentz invariance in the sense that if I now write down a Lagrangian for A mu, that is Lorentz invariant looking, meaning that all the contractions are done in the usual way. So if A mu were a four vector, it would be Lorentz invariant. Turns out A mu is not a four vector, but it transforms as a four vector plus what looks like a gauge transformation. So if the Lagrangian is also invariant under the formal replacement of A mu with A mu plus a gauge transformation, then the Lagrangian is truly Lorentz invariant. Okay, so gauge invariance from this viewpoint is just a trick to implement Lorentz invariance. Okay, as I said, this was sort of pedantic, but I think the conclusion is useful. Massless particles are tricky, number one, and number two, they need some form of gauge invariance to really have Lorentz invariant interactions. Okay, so if you repeat now the same exercise for massless spin two, so helicity plus and minus two, it's exactly the same. And the reason is that now helicity two, we need tensors because with a vector we cannot have more than spin one if you want, okay? The polarization tensors associated with helicity plus or minus 2, let's say in the reference frame in which I have k mu along the z-axis, are nothing but, if you notice, since the representations of these SO2 rotations now are super simple because they are just phases, I can just combine two phases, okay? So these are just the tensor products of helicity plus and minus 1. Okay, and in any other frame, you again do the Lorentz transformation of this. Okay, and in particular, since these guys did not transform nicely under the part of the little group that we don't want, since this is a scalar tensor part of these guys, it will have the same problem. Okay. Well, it's a definition. Again, the logic is we want to find something with the Lorentz indices that under rotations around the z-axis transforms with the right helicity, okay? And but helicity is just an overall phase, just an overall e to the I h theta, okay? So since I want here helicity plus or minus 2, and here I already had helicity plus or minus 1, that's multiply I get from here, no, and it's again because we are looking at a billion group of rotations SO2, so I just get phases rather than more complicated transformations. Okay, so I wouldn't say it's obvious, but it's clear. Okay, and so in particular, if you write it down explicitly, it looks like this, 1/2, zeros, okay, 1, okay. Now, those of you who have read some literature on gravitational waves recognize here the circular polarizations for gravitational waves, okay? And indeed, I mean, gravitational waves have helicity plus or minus 2 if you write them in circular polarizations. Okay, so this has the right helicity, meaning that I apply a rotation of angle theta to this guy, epsilon alpha beta plus or minus 2, okay. I get exactly the right helicity, e to the plus or minus I 2 theta, epsilon mu nu. Okay. But again, under transformations that have a non-trivial component in that extra part of the little group that we don't like, these epsilon mu nu do not transform nicely, because guys did not transform nicely to begin with. Okay. So if I construct a local field operator in the obvious way, again, sum over helicity plus or minus 2, d3p, square root of 2p0, epsilon mu nu helicity p ap, this is an operator, helicity e to the ipx, plus Hermitian conjugate, okay? Again, if I now look at how this thing transforms under a Lorentz transformation, so operator, I do the same manipulations that I did before, okay? And I get that it transforms as you expect, so mu alpha, let's say, mu beta, h alpha beta lambda x, plus an extra piece, which looks like this, d mu, some xi nu that depends on the Lorentz transformation I'm performing, plus the symmetrized version, d nu xi mu lambda x, okay? Okay, so it's Lorentz tensor. Under Lorentz transformations, it transforms the Lorentz tensor plus something else. Now, those of you who are familiar with general relativity expanded in perturbation theory around flat space, we recognize this as the gauge transformation associated with diffeomorphism invariance. Okay? So once again, for a massless particle with helicity plus or minus 2, diffeomorphism invariance or gauge invariance is not anything fundamental, is just something that you want to impose to have a truly Lorentz invariant theory. Because if you just contract indices in the Lagrangian, that would be a Lorentz invariant Lagrangian if this piece were not there, because H would transform as a tensor, but H does not transform as a tensor. H transforms as a tensor plus a gauge transformation. So you want the Lagrangian to be gauge invariant in order for it to be truly Lorentz invariant. Questions? Yes. Excellent question. Okay, so here's an epsilon that would work, let's say for spin one. So suppose for spin one, I look at this epsilon here. So the epsilon that we wrote down before, but let me look at this, p nu minus the symmetrized version, epsilon nu plus or minus one, p mu. Let me call this epsilon prime mu nu. So instead of looking at a vector, I'm looking at a tensor for it. Okay? So this has everything that we need, because under helicity, let's look at it in the preferred reference frame, okay? Where this is K. So in the preferred reference frame, under rotation about the z-axis, this is helicity plus or minus one. This does not transform, because by definition K does not transform. This has helicity plus or minus one, and this does not transform. So overall, this has helicity plus or minus one. But also now, under the infamous little group transformations associated with A and B, it transforms trivially, which is what we want. Because remember, this guy, under these transformations, was transforming into itself plus something proportional to k mu. So we would have k mu, k nu, minus k nu, k mu. So this is exactly in the same representation as the single particle states that you want to describe. And in fact, if you think about it, okay, this is in Fourier transform nothing but the field operator, the polarization tensor associated with f mu nu. F mu nu, which is the field strength of a mu, if I expand A in polarization vectors, creation operators, etc., gets exactly these combinations, okay? Because these derivatives become, okay? So this is the polarization tensor, if you want, associated with an f mu nu. And f mu nu, we know, is gauge invariant, okay? So everything works out nicely, okay? So one could say, okay, why can't I just use f mu nu to describe the photon? Why do I need a mu? Well, it turns out that this is an experimental fact, that if you were just to write interactions involving f mu nu and never a mu, the force between two charges, quote unquote, which in this case would be two dipoles, because this would be dipole interactions, the would go down like 1r^4 rather than 1r². Okay? So the fact that we observe long range interactions that go down like 1/r² in terms of forces means that these derivatives are not there, at least in the leading interaction. So coming back to your question, you can always, by adding factors of k's, you can always come up with the right epsilons, okay? But those factors of k give you much softer interactions at long distances. So in the end, it's an experimental fact. Yes, and I don't know how to prove it, but the claim is that you cannot, and the reason is that okay, I have to think about it. I mean, I remember I saw an argument, but I don't remember it. I have to think about it. Yeah, it's a good question, of course. I mean, the cheap answer is if you try, you cannot do it. But there's a more more refined version of that. More questions? Excuse me? Very good. So for spin 1/2, you don't need all this because spin 1/2 already, everything already works out, meaning that you can find polarization spinors that are in exactly the same representations as the single particle states. For spin 3/2, you can do it, and you end up with the theory for a gravitino, okay, which is in supersymmetric theory is the partner of the graviton, okay. And yes, in principle you could keep going higher and higher. In practice, it's very difficult to find. So at the level of representations, yes, you can do it, but it's very difficult to find consistent interacting theories of particles with spin higher than 2. Okay. String theory is a very nice example of that, in which from the viewpoint of particle physics you have infinitely many states with infinitely many spins, but they are all connected in a non-trivial way. But yes, from the viewpoint of representations and local field operators, you can do the same. Okay. Let me just comment. So you see, now we see from viewpoint of representations of the Lorentz group, etc., emergence of gauge invariant field strengths. Okay, we can do the same for H mu nu. By the way, H mu nu, of course, will be the field associated with our gravitons. And for those of you familiar with, again, the perturbative expansion of GR, H mu nu is the perturbation of the metric around the flat space. But we don't need that interpretation for the moment. But we can construct a gauge invariant field operator, which again is just another way of saying a truly covariant Lorentz tensor, meaning something that transforms really as a tensor under Lorentz transformations. Okay, so the easy way to do it is, since the epsilon plus or minus 2 for H mu nu was just the tensor product of this guy, okay. And this particular combination now of momentum at these guys is really a nice tensor under Lorentz transformations in this sense. Okay, then I can just take the tensor product of the two of these guys. Okay, if I do that to construct a non-trivial covariant tensor, if I do that, what I end up with is this: R mu nu rho sigma is 1/2 up to polarizations, up to normalizations. Let me write it down. Mu, rho. So if you want, this is the analog of that. The mu, the mu, the rho, mu, the sigma, h, nu, rho. And this is a true tensor, meaning if I apply this Lorentz transformation as unit operators, I get just Lorentz matrices like this without these extra pieces. All these extra pieces cancel, okay? And it turns out that if you take GR, you look at the Riemann tensor associated with a given metric, and you expand about flat space plus small perturbations H mu nu for the metric, this is precisely the linearized version of the Riemann tensor. And we know that the Riemann tensor GR is gauge invariant. Okay? Is invariant under gauge transformation. So again, we see the emergence of the Riemann tensor of general relativity simply from studying how different polarizations of the graviton, in this case, transform under Lorentz transformations. What time should I stop? Now, before one, okay. Yes, okay. Questions? Now, so these are the fields that create and transform, sorry, create and destroy massless, free massless particles with spin, meaning with non-trivial ellipticities. Okay. Now I want to study interactions. Okay. Now interactions, as we said, to be truly compatible with Lorentz invariant, have to be Lorentz invariant looking, so you contract indices, but also have to be invariant under gauge transformations. Otherwise, they are not truly Lorentz invariant. So let's see what the possible interactions are. Okay. Gauge invariant tensors like this guy or this guy to write down interactions, and that's a possibility, but that's not the most interesting possibility, meaning that nature apparently has more relevant interactions in the both in the colloquial and the technical sense, meaning that they are more important at large distances than this one, because these guys come with extra derivatives. Derivatives are associated with at last distances, they carry 1 over r, or in particle physics, they carry energy. Okay, so at low energies, the fewer number of derivatives you have, the more relevant something is. Okay, so there are more relevant interactions that we can write down that are still compatible with Lorentz invariance and gauge invariance. And they take this form. Suppose in the Lagrangian, let's start with the a mu, okay, with the photon. Suppose in the we want to couple the photon to other particles, let's say electrons or other particles, okay? And suppose these other particles obey a conservation equation, okay? That there is an operator J2 whose divergence is zero. So for electrons, that's the, let's say, electromagnetic current, okay? That then in the interaction Lagrangian between a mu and these matter fields, I can write down a term like a mu j mu. This is Lorentz invariant looking, meaning the connection is right, but is it truly Lorentz invariant? Well, our test now is that it should be gauge invariant to be truly Lorentz invariant, okay? So under a gauge transformation, so if I perform a gauge transformation a mu plus d mu of a generic lambda, okay? This, the variation of the interaction Lagrangian is d mu lambda j mu, okay? As usual, in a Lagrangian density, I can integrate by parts, okay? So this is lambda d mu j mu. But d mu j mu is zero. So this is zero. So interaction like this is Lorentz invariant because it is gauge invariant. And indeed, that's how the photon couples to leading order in low energies, couples to charged particles. Okay, and now we can do the same for the graviton. Okay, for the graviton, we could use that R mu nu sigma that we wrote down, that's truly gauge invariant, that's gauge invariant, so it's truly a Lorentz tensor, okay? But there's another possibility which mimics this very closely. Suppose you have a tensor now, let me call it J mu nu, which is conserved, okay, for other fields. And suppose in the interaction Lagrangian, you have H mu nu, J mu nu. Notice, by the way, that by construction, H mu nu is symmetric because the polarization tensors we are using are symmetric, okay? So the only non-trivial part in this contraction is the symmetric part, okay? Okay, now when I, so let's assume that J mu nu is symmetric. Okay? Now when I perform a gauge transformation on H mu nu, to check whether this is really gauge invariant or Lorentz invariant. So generic gauge transformation looks like this. By the way, there's a caveat, okay? When I perform these Lorentz transformations, the gauge transformation part that I get here depends on the Lorentz transformation. And it's a specific but somewhat complicated combination of creation and deletion operators, etc. So formally, from Lorentz transformations, I don't get the most general gauge transformation. I get specific xi mu's that depend on lambda. However, their expressions are so messy and complicated that probably the theory is invariant under these specific gauge transformations only if it is invariant under generic gauge transformations. I don't know if there is a proof of this, but if you look at these expressions, they're so awful that there's no real hope that you can have a theory invariant only under these specific combinations and not under more general gauge transformations. But that's a possible caveat. I don't know if there's a formal proof that it's not an issue. Okay? So let's perform a generic gauge transformation of this form, assuming that the xi mu's now are generic. So the interaction Lagrangian, we can do exactly the same as before, becomes interaction Lagrangian plus d mu xi nu plus d nu xi mu contraction nu. Okay. Again, I can integrate by parts. In fact, j mu nu is symmetric, so these two terms are the same up to a factor of 2. Okay, and so when I integrate by parts, I get, let's write it here, interaction Lagrangian minus 2 xi nu d mu j mu nu. D mu j mu nu is 0, and so this is gauge invariant. Okay, so bottom line is that the most interesting interactions at low energies or at large distances that we can write down for a spin 1 massless particle or a spin 2 massless particle involve terms like this, where our field operators couple to conserved quantities with the right number of indices. Okay? With the right number of indices. Now, you already know from GR, which we are supposed to forget for a second, but let's pretend that we remember that GR exists now. You already know that gravity couples to the stress energy tensor of matter. Okay? And which is certainly, at least in flat space, we will see how we go from flat space to the more nonlinear version of GR with covariant derivatives, etc. Okay? But certainly in flat space, the stress energy tensor is conserved, okay? And one question here is that the only possibility or not? Meaning, are there other rank 2 tensors, symmetric 2 tensors we could have written down that are conserved? Meaning, is gravity forced to couple to the stress energy tensor, or can it couple to a more general tensor, okay? The answer will be that there's no ambiguity. To lowest order in derivative interactions, meaning lowest order in derivatives I can have in these interactions, and to lowest, or equivalently in particle physics, to lowest order in energies, if I work at low energies, the stress energy tensor is unique, and so the rank 2 tensor to which the graviton can couple is unique, up to an overall normalization, which will turn out to be related to the Newton constant. So I'll stop here, and tomorrow I'll conclude this program, meaning I will show how all the properties that we know and love of general relativity follow from this. In particular, the equivalence principle is not a principle, it will turn out to be a theorem from this approach. And then we see how to construct the fully nonlinear action for the gravitational field following from here. And it will turn out to be GR and nothing else. Questions?